Thank you. Thank you. This fantastic venue and this fantastic evening brings to the end our election campaign, and tomorrow we're out knocking on doors like our life depends on it, as the lives of many do. And I want to thank Emily Sande and all the other artists that have contributed to this campaign, to our party, and to that inspirational evening we had when we were at the Theatre Royal in Stratford, because socialism is about hope, it's about inclusion, it's about prosperity for all, but it's also about imagination and music for all. And so I want to thank fellow MPs, candidates, sorry, MPs tomorrow, who spoke earlier, Meg, Emily, Diane, who spoke earlier, and of course Dawn, who did the introductions, and our fantastic junior doctors for the speech they gave earlier. I also want to apologise to Islington North Labour Party for not doing as much canvassing as I normally do. I've managed to get to most of the wards. Don't worry, justice will be done tomorrow. But I just want to say an enormous thank you to them for the incredible amount of work they do day in, day out to make Islington North such a strong place for Labour, but also a place of such determination and such hope. And I'm so grateful for them, not just for the support they've given during this election campaign, but for the teaching they helped me with and the issues they raise with me and the discussions we have. Because politics has always got to be interaction, engagement, and recognising we can all learn from each other. Never get so high and mighty, you can't learn from other people. And so to all of the Islington North Party that are around here, and our wonderful chair, Alison, for her speech earlier, thank you very, very much indeed. I'd also like to say a big thank you to the events team of the Labour Party organisation, all of the team we've got in head office, in my office, and all of the regional offices, because this has been the most incredible election campaign. We're not funded by billionaires. We don't have any big backers. What we have is trade unions that support us and members who give us their money. The Tory party might be happy with the money from billionaires. We've received £5 million in £25 donations from 200,000 people all across the country. That is a sign of real strength of our movement, the way in which we do business and the way in which we put our views forward. I've just come from the end of a 500-mile journey today. We were determined to get to as many places around the country as we can. Altogether in the campaign, I've been to, I think, 85 constituencies. And we've done rallies, meetings, demonstrations, visited people, visited lots of places, done lots of big events, small events and so on, all over the country. And it was quite extraordinary. It was 7:30 this morning in Govan in Glasgow. There was a rally on the street and it stopped raining for about half an hour. And apparently it wasn't cold by Glasgow standards. But again, the enthusiasm was there. And I tell you what, the Labour Party in Scotland is coming back. We're going to gain seats all across Glasgow. And at the weekend, we were all over in Wales, and the biggest event that's been held for apparently 100 years took place in Haverford West in Priscilla Pembroke constituency. And it's that's happening all over the country, in the big cities, the small places, and all the rest of it. You wouldn't know it from much of the media reporting of the election. It's commentators speculating on other commentators who speculate. No, we believe in a free press. I just wish they'd free themselves from the shackles of the billionaires. Because the issues in this election are actually very, very profound. Most people say at most elections, this is the most important election there's ever been. And if you're a candidate, it always feels like that. Trust me, I've done it 10 times. But the issues in this election are so very, very important and very, very profound. We're literally at a fork in the road. We're at a fork in the road in this election. If Boris Johnson and the Tories are re-elected, no, don't say anything yet. If they're re-elected, we are living in a country that's already grievously divided between rich and poor, that's already suffering austerity in every conceivable way, and I'll come on to more of that in a moment. And it's a government that will take us into the direction of a trade deal with the United States, with Donald Trump, that will break off relations with Europe, which will turn this country into some kind of tax haven dominated by multinational corporations who will demand and get free rein from an incoming Tory government as to how they're going to do business. That is what the Tories will do. That is the choice. Or we can go another way. The Labour manifesto is what we said. There's no other government going to happen. It's either a Tory government or a Labour government that's going to be there on Friday. The Labour way, our manifesto, written by all of you and by thousands and thousands of people all over the country, through their resolutions to party meetings, through their demands, through union conferences, through their contribution in letters, emails, and conversations with all of us, have made our manifesto something that I think we can all be very, very proud of. Because that manifesto encompasses the hopes and dreams of so many people all around this country. And I'm utterly determined that we win this election to carry it out. Because there's a choice also. There's also a choice about the style and type of government you want. Boris Johnson, well, I don't want to get personal about this. But I just put it this way. Today, I've been going around the country delivering what I hope is a message of hope to people all around the country. Boris Johnson started the day pretending to deliver milk and then ended up in a fridge. Well, our party doesn't need to pretend, and we certainly don't need to hide in a fridge, because we're not afraid. Because we're not afraid of questions that may be put to us. In fact, we rather welcome them and relish those opportunities. And so our manifesto takes with it the hopes of so many people, the dreams of so many people of what kind of society we could be. Because we've gone so far backwards in the past 9 years. 9 years ago, the Tories and Lib Dems got together and decided that they would go down the road of austerity, a political choice. Political choice to cut spending to local government, political choice to freeze welfare spending, political choice to freeze public sector wages, political choice to underfund the National Health Service, political choice to treble university fees, a political choice to impose poverty on the already poorest people in the country, including cutting welfare benefits to those with disabilities, as well as introducing a cruel and brutal sanctions regime through universal credit. They did all that knowing exactly what the consequences were. And Theresa May, as Home Secretary, quite specifically and quite deliberately created the hostile environment for the Windrush generation that come from all parts of the world and have made their homes and made such a fantastic contribution to our society. They did all that knowing what the consequences would be. And as a result, 10 years later, many working class communities all over Britain have seen a loss of spending power of around 20 to 25%. And you see that in the boarded up shops, the dilapidated high streets, the closed youth centres, the closed and sold off libraries, all that destruction of the commonplace, the public realm, all that destruction of things that glued communities together, underfunding police, etc., etc. That was a deliberate political choice. And I remember in Parliament when David Cameron said, well, we're all in it together. No, we're not. Oh, no, we're not. They're absolutely not in it together. The last 10 years, there's a number of billionaires. The number of billionaires in Britain has grown considerably. There's now 150 billionaires in Britain. And do you know what? These billionaires are actually quite mean, because only 50 of them who've done so well out of the coalition government and the Tory government, only 50 of them have contributed to Tory party funds. So Tory party funds must be really stretched when they're missing the contribution of 100 billionaires when there's only 50 billionaires contributing to them. And so I think words should be said. But also those that have great wealth, the wealthiest in our country, the biggest landowners, the richest people in Britain, have seen their personal wealth double in the last 10 years. Whereas the average worker has gone through frozen wages, loss of conditions, loss of opportunity, and young people have gone through the horrors and indignities of massive debt because they wanted to go to university and get a degree. That was the choice they made. So when the election comes tomorrow, it is a very clear choice. You go down the road of Boris Johnson, a sweetheart deal with Donald Trump, you break off any serious relationship with Europe, or you go down the Labour way, which is the adult responsible way of negotiating a settlement that we will all live by and I will make sure is carried out in the future relationship with Europe. But we also go down the road of investing in our country, investing to end austerity and redistributing wealth and power in our society in a way that's never been seen before by any government in Britain. Because the fundamentals of our manifesto are actually about empowerment of people in so many areas. I could give you so many examples, but you're not allowed to be here all night because you've got to be out early in the morning delivering those leaflets and knocking up. I'll just give you this one. Think through the education system we have at the present time. Think through the number of children that don't get to go to a nursery place, either because one isn't available, or their parents can't afford it, or they're not eligible for it, or it simply can't be found. Those children lose out. A child that doesn't get to go to a nursery is much less likely to do particularly well later on in school, and a lot of independent studies show by the time they reach 18, they could be as much as 18 months behind the rest of their cohort in academic achievement. And then you look at the number of children now taught in oversized classes, sometimes with an unqualified teacher standing in the front of the class. And they're going to school hungry because their parents are not able to feed them properly. It's Food Bank Britain and Poverty Britain and poor children underachieving in school as a result of that. And teachers who cannot cope with the stress of the testing regime, the league table regime, and the pressure they're under, leaving a profession they loved and a job that they thought was their vocation. So what have we done to our education system other than underfund it, overtest it, overpressurize it, and the outcomes get worse and worse? Can't we instead look at it slightly differently and say, take the principle of the commodity out of education and replace it with the right to education. The right of a child to get a nursery place, the right of a child to be taught in a reasonable sized class, the right of a child to have a qualified teacher, and the right of a child and their parents and their teacher not to go through the unbelievable stress that's imposed on them through Key Stage 1 and Key Stage 2 testing. It's that sort of thing that we need to change, and our National Education Service will change that. We'll change it by investing in education. We'll change it by valuing equally a vocational qualification, an apprenticeship, a technical qualification, or getting an academic qualification. And we will end university fees once and for all to take that debt away. And properly fund our adult education system. Will this cost money? Yes, it will cost money. The National Education Service will be there to make sure the money is available and properly spent. And we've made it very clear, in order to pay for this, we will raise corporation tax up to 26% in order to properly fund our services. Because our manifesto is fully costed and fully prepared for every department. And so on Friday, hopefully, when we go into government, that manifesto will be deposited there. This is our programme. This is our manifesto. This is what we wish to carry out in government. For education is absolutely crucial to the lives of all of us. But so is also living with the safety of knowing you've got a National Health Service that you can rely on. The National Health Service is our movement's greatest achievement. It came from Tredegar, and Aaron Bevan learnt the lesson in Tredegar about the community provision of health in the mining community there. And the National Health Service came in 1948. The more I study it, the more I read about it, the more I listen to some very old people that were there at the time, you just admire so much what Aaron Bevan and those in the Labour government did at that time. I'm sure they were given lots of advice as soon as they became ministers in 1945. Minister, the country's in difficulties. We've just had the Second World War. I said, yeah, I know that. And we can't possibly afford these grandiose schemes. Why don't we have a royal commission to think about it? And it could report in maybe 10 years' time and we could think about it then. He said, no, we were elected to do it and we will do it. And with all those difficulties, they won the principle of healthcare free at the point of need. And it is a principle that this party, this movement, will never, ever go away from. But it is under threat. There's no question it is under threat. It is under threat from the Health and Social Care Act, which the Liberal Democrats and the Tories put through, which has been a pathway for £10 billion of privatisation within the NHS already. And when we challenged the government, the Tories, on the private secret talks they're having with the USA, we asked for the documents. I showed them in the first head-to-head debate, and somebody had been awfully busy with a Sharpie pen. They'd crossed out every single line of every single meeting, of every single decision that was made. All you knew was a meeting took place. It didn't even tell you whether they had tea, coffee or biscuits. I don't know. Shocking business. And then we looked at the US documents and found, yes, they had been discussing what the meeting euphemistically called access to public services in Britain in a future trade relationship. Access to our health market. I didn't know we had a health market. I thought we had a National Health Service. I thought that's what it was called. And then we got all the documents and we released those to the public 2 weeks ago. And those documents showed the full horror of what was going on. Meeting in secret, they were negotiating with big pharmaceutical companies in the USA an extension of patent rights and times in order to increase costs of specialist medicines for our NHS. They were negotiating with them access to our health market and all of our other public services. And they were negotiating what they call investor state protection, which would mean they would be protected against any kind of radical move of an incoming government, something like, say, £10 an hour living wage or right to join a trade union, right to be represented, all those kind of things. That is what they were in secret negotiating away. That is what Boris Johnson would continue doing, elected again on Friday, destroying our public services on the altar of a global free market dominated by a small number of multinational companies. Are we seriously going to allow our public services to be ripped up and destroyed by this person, by that government? So anyone that says there's no choice in this election, there's very much a choice. There's never been, ever, in British history, a clearer choice in the election that's being held tomorrow. And I'm very proud of the manifesto that we've got, and there's so much that's in it, and so much work that's gone into it. We, on this planet now, we do face the gravest, greatest crisis there has ever been. It is obvious that global warming is taking place. It's obvious the levels of pollution, particularly of seas and rivers, have got worse. And it's obvious that the impoverishment of the poorest communities are first affected by global warming. Look at the sea rises, look at the unusual weather patterns, the floods, the droughts that take place as a result of it. You cannot ignore it. And there are millions of people around the world that grossly affected by this, and there are many who in reality are environmental refugees in various places because of deforestation, because of desertification. And in this country we do have unusual weather patterns. We do have increased flooding. We do have real problems. We also suffer from totally unacceptable levels of air pollution in many of our cities. In Glasgow, you've got the shortest life expectancy anywhere in Britain, and you've got the greatest gap between the richest and the poorest getting wider all the time. And in some parts of the country, there's actually a falling, not a rising, life expectancy, and a rising, not a falling, infant mortality rate. And so the combination of class issues and environment actually come together. And so we have worked on how we deal with this. Do we sort of run away and say you can do absolutely nothing about it and just kind of hope it gets to be all right in the end? Or do we just stand by as spectators, watch the Amazon rainforest burn, the West African rainforest burn, our own natural world be damaged and destroyed, and we carry on polluting as we were? Or do we be more smart, more sensible, more intelligent, and more creative about it? Hence the idea in the USA of the Green New Deal, here of the Green Industrial Revolution. And that Green Industrial Revolution is about investment in renewable energy, is about investment in wind, in wave, in solar, is about the Swansea Bay Lagoon, is about the Mersey Barrage, is about retrofitting millions of homes in order that they use less heat, and the people are warmer and they pay less as a result of it. And think of all the jobs that are created by the manufacture of the solar panels, the wind generators, the barrage, and all the retrofitting of homes. Think also of the improvements in our natural world by tree planting, by allowing nature to take over in some places to improve biodiversity, and the way in which we interact with nature and the way in which we run our agriculture. And that we have a trade policy and a foreign policy that reflects our needs to change our ways. 2015, Paris Climate Change Accord was a huge step forward. I was there, it was fascinating, I learned a great deal from it, but it didn't go far enough. On current prospects, Britain will only meet zero net emissions by 2099, the rest of the world by 21, goodness knows when. It's going to be too late. It'll be too late for many people and many places by then, and many species, and our own lifestyles will be severely damaged. So we are determined to try and reach net zero as quickly as we can, and if we can do it by 2030, I'll be the most pleased man in the whole country as a result of that. So it'll be our determination to do that. And next year, a Labour government hosting COP26 in Britain, working with other countries to strengthen, not weaken, the Paris Climate Change Agreement. And so we use our technology, our brilliance, our strength, our intelligence in order to confront the greatest problem that we face. Previous industrial revolutions were always a transfer of wealth and power from the poorest to the richest. This one will be different. This will be an investment in forgotten communities all over Britain that have seen nothing since the end of the miners' strike, that have only seen their work replaced by zero-hours contracts and fly-by-night employers. This is about investing in the future of all parts of Britain. And I'm determined that our Labour government will be doing that. We'll do that through our National Investment Bank. We'll do that through regional transformation funds. We'll do that by giving people rights at work, by raising the living wage to £10 an hour from next year, by giving people rights at work from day one when they start those jobs. Because people have been underpaid, underfunded, and underregarded for too long. Too many young people's lives have been stunted and ruined by the way in which austerity has worked on them. So it is our duty, our moral duty, to make sure that we do something about it. And I'll be very proud to win an election and start doing all of that work. But it's also about righting some of the wrongs of the past, such as the disgraceful way the WASPI women were treated in 2011, when they were deceived by the government and lost a lot of pension as a result of it. And when we announced that we would compensate the WASPI women and treat them properly, a lot of journalists came to me and said, well, hang on a minute, that means some slightly better off women will get the same benefits as others. I said, yeah, they've paid national insurance all their lives. It's called a universal benefit. Have you got a problem with that? And then you realise it's a sort of drip, drip, drip argument that somehow or other you've got to get rid of the principle of universality in the welfare state and replace it by some kind of insurance-based system. I believe very strongly in the universality of benefits, which is why our government will end universal credit and the disgrace of the two-child policy that's in operation at the present time and the way in which people with disabilities are treated. And so, it's also about us and about our sense of community. Our country is diverse. People from all parts of the world make their homes here, and people make a fantastic contribution here. It was the Tories that set up the whole intention behind the hostile environment, which has been so grievously hit, particularly the Afro-Caribbean community in Britain that have made such massive contributions. But it's also the poison of racism in our society, the way in which the far right seek to divide people. The far right always seek to divide people. It's their stock in trade. You blame this minority, you blame that minority, you blame this refugee, that migrant worker. There's always somebody you can blame. There's always somebody worse off than you. There's always some identifiable minority you can blame. At the end of it, you've just created a vortex of hatred. You haven't built a school, you haven't built a hospital, you haven't trained a teacher, you haven't got a nurse. And the poison of anti-Semitism, the poison of Islamophobia, the poison of racism will never, ever be allowed to exist in our party, our movement, or our country under a Labour government. Because that is the kind of world and kind of society that we want to live in. And our movement has many, many inspirational figures that went before us, those that fought for trade union rights, those that gained the rights for women, those that marched in all the major cities, those that made a stand in order to stand up for others that they might do better in the future. So our manifesto is a product of all that debate and all that discussion within our party and our movement, but it's also a product of centuries of radical work by many people who had the vision of a society where you care for all, not just a few, where you challenge the wealthy and the powerful. Our government will be challenged by the wealthy and the powerful, I've no doubt about that. It will be challenged by the billionaire owners of certain media outlets who apparently don't like me very much. I mean, I'll tell you what, I don't read all the daily papers actually, but I hear about it later. Thank you very much. But I hear about it later in the day. And those that, and if any of our political opponents or anybody else chooses to inhabit a gutter in order to which to throw mud around, that's absolutely fine by me. I hope they enjoy it down there in the gutter, but I won't be joining them. Because we have more important things to do. We have more important things to do to cut past all that and raise the sights and hopes of people, work with people as they develop and improve their communities, work with people under a Labour government that's trying to develop all the things that we're so proud of in our manifesto, but also recognising the work of so many that went before. And if I could finish on this, many people have inspired me in my life. Not famous people, people that have given an awful lot of themselves in order to improve their communities. Those that have stood up under the most appalling difficulties and tragedies, but nevertheless had the inspiration to think of what would be better for the next generation. One such person that inspires me is the Chilean poet Victor Jara. Victor Jara was a singer, a poet, and he worked endlessly to get the Popular Unity government elected in Chile in 1970, and it duly was. And he supported that government through thick and thin, and it had the most appalling attacks. And after the coup in 1973, he was arrested, like thousands of others, and taken to the stadium. And the soldiers soon worked out who he was. And after they'd shot a number of people and tortured them in front of everybody else, they invited Victor to come to the middle of the stage, in the center of the stadium, and say, here's a guitar. You can sing for us now. And he went to the center of the stadium, picked up the guitar that had been put there. He was quite surprised by this. He thought this was odd. And what they did was cut his fingers off in front of everybody else and then shot him. they smashed his hands that he might never play again. He wrote a poem called, "My guitar is not for the rich. No, nothing like that. My song is of the ladder we are building to reach the stars." Thank you very much.